The greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist.
All right, you all know the drill.
And that was how it started. The five of us being brought in on a trumped-up charge to be leaned on by half-wits.
Number one, step forward.
It didn't make sense that I'd be there. I mean, these guys were hardcore hijackers.
Answer my question.
And you hit me in the back. Hello?
What the cops never figured out, and what I know now, was that these men would never break, never bend over for anybody.
You gonna charge me?
You don't put guys like that into a room together.
Let's get back to that truck.
Who knows what can happen?
Well, I figure we owe it to ourselves to salvage a little dignity. Me and Fenster heard about a little job.
My employer requires your services, gentlemen. One job, one day's work. Very dangerous.
12 squadrons, 10, maybe 20 men. Anybody goes in there is not coming out alive.
Is there a problem?
I want to know why 27 men died on that pier for what looks to be $91 million worth of dope that wasn't there.
This isn't life's in danger.
He saw the devil.
Kaiser Soze!
He mentioned Kaiser Soze.
Who? Who's Kaiser Soze? Uh-huh.
Press 20. Do it now.
There is no Kaiser Soze.
You never knew. That was his power.
He was in the harbor, killing many men.
You mention his name again, I'll kill you right now.
How do you shoot the devil in the back?
A gift from Mr. Soze.
You got my whole life in here. Everything I've ever done since I was 18.
Everybody I've ever worked with at a time with.
Keaton always said, I don't believe in God, but I'm afraid of him.
He's here.
Well, I believe in God. And the only thing that scares me is Kaiser Soze. And like that, he's gone.
The greatest trick a podcast ever pulled was convincing the world that it did exist and they should listen to it. And tonight, this podcast is going back to the late 1900s, to what I describe as a post-Tarantino world, to talk about the 1995 Bryan Singer masterpiece, The Usual Suspects. And as usual, I'm not alone. First up is a man. The fuck is he doing? First up is a man who desperately wishes he was once in a barbershop quartet in Skokie, Illinois. Mr. Christopher Mars, how are you doing this evening and what are you drinking?
I am doing well, Michael. I am drinking an IPA, an 87, Night Shift 87 IPA, which is, I'm trying to think of how it would pertain to the movie. It's 87 is 11 times less than the F word is uttered in this movie.
Well, there you go. There's a tie. There's a tie right there. And next up is a man who used to pick beans in Guatemala, used to make fresh coffee right off the trees. Mr. David Corsetto, how are you doing, sir? And what is in your glass this evening?
Okay, I'm doing fine. But didn't you get that already in the beginning when I'm drinking?
There's a process.
The show hadn't
changed. I attempted for the first time to actually put some thought into the drink I was going to participate in tonight. And I did it, but it sucks. So I'm going to just say it. I bought Wild Turkey American Honey because, again, I said earlier on this pod, this cast of characters are definitely wild, but they go down like honey because it's such a smooth movie. This is one of the smoothest movies I've seen in a while.
That Kevin Spacey is a honey of a...
Listen, I'll tell you, I thought Kevin Spacey was, the first time I watched it, I'm like, okay, definitely a little weird. The ending, obviously we'll get to it, but what a fucking performance.
Yes, he is. Now,
we'll let Mikey do his numbers, but yeah. I don't care what he did off camera.
What are you drinking, Mikey? Oh, me? thank you. So, because I'm not done yet. I'm really thirsty. I used to dehydrate as a kid. One time I got a piss so bad, my piss came out like snot. I'm not kidding. It was all thick and gooey.
That actually is a true story, too.
Yes. Well, actually, no, it came out like chocolate milk. And did I mention to you guys, I did mention to the guys that we should drink the usual tonight, but they went off and found something interesting. For me, this evening, I thought I would drink something really special. That's why I am having a Bud Light Seltzer hard orange soda in my brand new Teen Wolf commemorative cup.
Wow.
It's my new podcasting cup, my official podcasting cup. If I'm doing podcasting and I'm drinking anything out of it, it's in my new Teen Wolf cup.
Well, just so you know, excellent. Excellent job. But we're not ever doing Teen Wolf.
Oh, God, no. God, no. No. But it will be, he'll be there every time.
For the record, Kevin's...
Sorry, let me just real quickly say this, though. I'm going to say I call bullshit on whatever's in that cup that Mikey's drinking, because I guarantee it's probably like soda.
I just said it's Bud Light Seltzer hard orange soda.
Oh, okay. All right.
That sounds yummy. So
their hard soda is
My son just said it's really good, actually.
It's really good. It's surprisingly good. Even the
not
cola.
Too sweet.
It's sweet. But it's like drinking out of the cola is like drinking a Diet Coke with alcohol in it. Mwah. Mwah.
Okay. For the record, Kevin Spacey did have something come out that was thick like snot, but it was not pee on many a set. Sorry.
Oh man.
That makes that scene disturbing now.
But, I have to tell you, when I put on this movie for the first time, I watched this in the 90s when it first came out. I remember watching it. I think we rented it with friends. We never got to it. So I put it on late at night and I was like, what the hell am I watching? I was blown away by obviously the ending, and coming back to it this time around, I couldn't believe that it was only an hour and 47 minutes. Like, it was a short, it didn't take its time. It just went.
Yeah, right. Not a lot of fat. That's right. For sure. The crisp, clean.
I was like, I was expecting 2 hours and 20 minutes, you know, something like that. But
no unnecessary scene.
Right. And it could be because it's a young director. This film, I said, came out in 1995, directed by Bryan Singer, who went on to great acclaim with the X-Men movies, but he did the first two, left to do Superman Returns, came back, did a couple more, had some other movies in there. I don't know if you ever saw Apt Pupil. That was pretty good.
Stephen King.
Yep, with Ian McKellen. I think he was in that as well. And somewhere along the way,
What is going on over here?
He got canceled as well. This is a movie of guys who are no longer really working. The last Bryan Singer credit was Bohemian Rhapsody, but he didn't even finish directing that. I don't know. There was all kinds of weirdness on the set, from my understanding. And you know what? As we are here on our 30-something episode, Dave still does not hit mute on his Zoom. He's quietly talking to his son. But anyway. As I said, directed by Bryan Singer, written by Christopher McQuarrie, who I was like, why do I know that name so well? And I realized he's the writer and director of the last two next two Mission Impossible movies. And he wrote Top Gun Maverick.
Boring.
Did he really?
You don't.
Sorry. Listen, Top Gun Maverick, fantastic. Mission Impossible's I've never seen.
Well, that's the second one. They're great. And I'm sorry, Dave, but I'm going to also tell the people who are starring in the movie. Do you want to have Andrew on the show, or are you just going to keep looking?
Come on, Andrew, get on. Has he seen this movie?
He's eating. This is Anyway, I'm not editing that shit out. This movie is starring Kevin Spacey, Gabriel Byrne, Stephen Baldwin, Chaz Palminteri, Benicio del Toro. I put Chaz Palminteri twice, even though I should have put Kevin Pollak and, God, what the hell is his name? Pete Postlewaite. Did I say that right?
Yeah, Pete Postlewaite. This is our second Pete Postlewaite movie.
Yes, our second one.
Okay, and can I just say this for all the listeners out there? if you're going to watch it, obviously watch it without subtitles, obviously, at one point. But then you have it. To watch it with subtitles, because there's one character in this fucking movie that you can't understand one fucking thing he's saying until you watch it with subtitles.
He'll flip you for real. That's fantastic. Yeah. Del Toro actually decided to just, that was his like creative decision.
I thought that's how he talked.
Like that. And the director didn't know, Singer didn't know if he was doing it as a joke. So they didn't say anything. And then they were like, wow, that actually just makes him interesting. And because he didn't really love his storyline. It wasn't much.
He didn't have yet. Not as
for
much.
Him to do. So he mixed it up and had that crazy mumble.
So just some stats on the movie. It had an 89% on Rotten Tomatoes for the critics, 96 for the audience score, 77 on Metacritic. It wasn't a huge box office movie, but it wasn't a big budget movie. It's only a $6 million budget, only made $23 million. I don't think it was a widely released movie, is my guess. But it did win two Academy Awards, Best Original Screenplay for Christopher McQuarrie and Best Supporting Actor for Kevin Spacey as Verbal. Kint. Did I get that right?
Yeah, K-I-N-T. Yeah. I always thought it was Kent, but it is Kint. Incredible, really, really incredible performance too by him, right?
Everybody was good. This is a movie that even Stephen Baldwin couldn't ruin this movie.
Well, that's what I have written down. It's like, it's a great noir, like whodunit crime film. Yep. But there's also, like, Gabriel Byrne is awesome in this. You just rooting for him somehow. Chaz Palminteri's is great. Pollock is awesome. You know, as Hockney, Del Toro, as we mentioned, and Stephen Baldwin. If you watch this movie, you would be like, Stephen Baldwin is going to be a go on a run of movies or something. He's great. He's like a great action hero in this, and he's like charismatic. His career didn't turn out like you would think, but it was
See, he has the chops.
He does have the chops. And it's just, the story is so great. You think, the first time you watch it, you're really rooting for these guys too, right? You don't know how this story is something different than it seems, even. It just kind of seems like a crime drama, and you think they need to accomplish this mission. When it's, and like I said, I told you guys, I was kind of aggravated how it plays out because of the things that Verbal was narrating and you were seeing. And I'm like, okay, so Verbal can't be, because,
right.
But that's the genius of it. It's because he's an unreliable narrator.
Yep.
And they tell you he's an unreliable narrator he's lying. You see him lying. You know what I mean? You see him lying several times during his stories. So it's telling you, you know, he's not behind those ropes. There's nobody back there. So you should know the story is bullshit. So it's just,
it was bullshit when you first saw the movie, or did it? Obviously, you get it at the end, but did you stop picking up on his lying?
No, I didn't. I didn't really pick up on the things. Well, first of all, my buddy Mike, who's a big fan of this movie, also Mike Batts, he and I were talking about it. He sent me something. I don't know if you guys did any research on Sose means in Turkish means verbal, means very talkative and verbal.
Oh.
So the translation of Kaiser Sose is verbal. So kind of a clue right there. The other things, you know, that you could have seen were when Verbal
you wouldn't have saw the gold lighter until he picked up his gold lighter in the police spot.
Right, as it was getting to that. But yeah, no. So no, I absolutely didn't. Like I said, I was, you know, younger dope, and I was kind of not aggravated, but I was like, holy shit, I hope it's not him. Then I'm like, wait, how can they show you that, you know? And it's crazy how they show you Keaton get shot right away, but again, you're not sure if that's true because of this unreliable narrator. It's just a very, it's a great story how it,
yeah, unique. Are you laughing, Mikey?
No, I was waiting for you to say something. I'm not.
Okay, so you're laughing, you fucker. So when Hockney gets killed at the end, you see surprise in his eyes again, but you don't know if that's genuine or not. You don't know. I mean, obviously he dies, obviously, but you don't know if it's a genuine, hey, and that's what I started to realize. It was someone he knew that killed him. But I didn't know it was going to be Kevin Spacey's character. I thought it was actually going to be Keaton.
Oh, see, I thought Hockney is Kevin Pollak.
Yeah.
I just thought one of the guys there killed him. I didn't even really make the connection.
No, because the look on his face was complete surprise when he got shot and he turned around and saw who it was. But I thought, legit it was Keaton. Because
Keaton has a look of surprise too. Remember Keaton? Yeah. Keaton has a look of surprise when Kaiser, he says, I can't feel my legs. And then Kaiser goes to light a cigarette. And that's when Keaton's eyes like open up. Yeah. And he says,
and the way he calls him, he calls Kaiser. Like he's like, okay, I know who you are now. I read a couple of things on the IMDb trivia. One was that Bryan Singer kept telling them they all were Kaiser's Jose.
Yes. So
none of them knew quite until the end, until they saw the movie, I think. Gabriel Byrne was pissed. He was like, what is this? And then we'll get to the lineup scene, but there's some interesting things there.
Well, they set up that Keaton literally has faked his death many times. That's what puts that bug in your ear anyways. They go, you know, figure out, okay, is he really dead or not? I mean, because they don't show someone dying in the first scene and it actually be the actual ending. So
you didn't know. And like I said, it was coming off Miller's Crossing, well, obviously a few years before, but I always liked Gabriel Byrne. So you just rooted for him, even though he kind of a horrible character,
horrible person. Yeah.
Agent Kujan was telling, he's murdering prisoners and murdering people and murdering witnesses. And I'm like, wow, it's Gabriel Byrne. That's Tom.
I'm trying to figure out while watching the movie is how much of what we saw actually even happened.
Exactly.
Like even I know the Redfoot name, obviously we know where he got it, but did that even take place at all?
Well, you're like, is that a real guy? Is that guy even exist? Which obviously Pete Postlethwaite's character, who was not named Kobayashi, but he obviously existed.
Was he supposed to be South African or something? Or was it like, I was trying to figure out the accent. I was like, is he doing Indian? Or I don't know about.
Felt like a cross between English, South African, and even Irish.
Redfoot calls him a limey.
I did. I remember that, but his accent was so interesting.
Did that even happen? Did that even happen?
That's true.
Yeah. It's just such a great movie. And one thing I did also read, you talking about the trivia, that every time they mentioned Kaiser, they showed verbal in the next scene. I didn't need.
Oh, really?
I keep forgetting to try to check that if that's how that's
true. I was trying to look for clues, if there are any tells. Because the first time I didn't even cross my mind. So it's like, what the? But I wonder if there's little things like that. There must be.
I literally watched the thing 4 times in the last 3 days. So I try looking for tells, but really it's hard. They did a good job masking this movie.
Yeah. Great movie. So let's get into it.
Yes.
And
we got to start right at the production.
Good. Bad Hat Harry Productions. So I think that was from a previous movie.
That's his production company. But that I think I had Usual Suspects poster on my wall because I remember Bad Hat Harry and being like,
oh, really?
Wait a second.
I paused it during one watch and I'm like, Grace, come look at this. We know that's from Jaws, right? She's like, yeah, great.
Some bad hat.
So you get the opening shot, shots of the water, great cast. You get the great Pete Postlethwaite and the not so great Kevin Spacey. Nice little crime score. San Pedro, California last night.
I love that kind of that noir type thing last night.
Definitely. Awesome. Matches lit. You see Keaton lighting his smoke, sitting down. He's on the boat, and he tries to light the flame. And that's when you see someone pissing on it from up above.
Yep.
Grossed out thinking of Spacey pissing on anything.
Oh, he loved it. He was like, "I'll do it. No stunt. I'll do it."
Do you know? I don't want to go into a side thing on on Spacey, but you know the specifics of. I won't even get into.
I know there were some young actors, some that.
But you know what he found out who they were dating, like any young. There was a young person on the scene. They found out they were gay. He found out whoever they were dating, and he banged their boyfriend or
whatever. Oh my god! He nice made fella. Them the cuck. That's the second show in a row. Oh my god.
Okay, sorry about that side. Sorry, yeah.
He's so. When I think of the character he did in House of Cards, to this character, it's just like. I mean, yeah, I know it's a 20-year difference, but just the voice, everything. So, like,
so creepy in House of Cards. Yeah. So then you see someone walking down with a hat and a trench coat, walks up to Keaton. You see McManus on the ground with a knife in his back. How you doing, Keaton? Can't feel my legs. Then he uses the lighter. And he's like, Kaiser. Hello, Kaiser. He's like, ready.
And he says it like, oh, you, like you could read it two ways. Like, you must be Kaiser or, oh, you're Kaiser. Now I know.
Yeah, exactly. Which, right. We figure out looking back that that's how he looked at it. What time is it? 12:30. He
shuts his eyes and leans forward.
Yep. Takes out the gun. He shoots him twice. And then you see the shots of the carnage on the boat, drops a cigarette, flames, explosions. Then you see, this is when it pans in on the ropes.
And I was looking for something because I forgot.
Yeah. See, but it's like, many times I've watched it, I was like, oh, I forgot to mention, you were saying you've only seen it, you only saw it once. I'm surprised Dave hasn't seen it more because this was also a staple at Cox Lane because it was always on HBO.
I don't remember ever seeing it in Cox Lane.
Always. So next shot is Verbal, his face lit up, being interviewed.
It all started back in New York 6 weeks ago. A truck loaded with strip gun parts got jacked outside of Queens.
Then they show him didn't see anybody, but all getting arrested. McManus. He heard a voice.
Sometimes that's you pay.
That's funny. Hockney's working on the car. You got enough guys. He's pretty funny.
Oh yeah, I always like him.
All right. Fences is walking the street. Cops pull him over.
Even hit just the way he turns. He's trying to just walk the other way.
Keaton's
so young there too.
Is on a business dinner pitching something, and Chaz, Agent Kujan. Kuyan? Is it Kuyan? It's K-U-J.
I thought it was Kujan. Yeah, I don't know.
It is Kujan. He works for customs, leads the cops over to the table. You know, you look good. Oh, the guy says to him, you look good. You're supposed to be dead. Keaton's pissed off. Edie Finneran's there with him. Excuses himself. He needs to question him about the trucks. Verbal shot of his, we get him walking. Yeah, he's already doing the walk, right?
Oh yeah.
So it doesn't make sense why I'm here. So as we find out that who set up this lineup, it was Kobayashi. Him. Kobayashi,
yeah, okay, yeah.
Which is right. Verbal. So somehow Verbal got himself arrested. I mean, there's some questions. It's like, how would this huge Turkish drug lord get a reputation as a petty thief, con man, you know what I mean? Like, some people question whether he actually is guy's associate, whether it's Sose, whether it's, you know,
that people, he works for.
People have theories, right? Or if he's like the right hand man, or even if
Pete Postle,
exactly. So, the great lineup shot, it's on the poster, you know.
Well, that fax at the end could have been either of them, really, right?
Well, no, here's the thing about the facts. Or should I wait till we get
I know what you're saying. It's who they saw at the dock. So it doesn't matter, right?
Who they saw killing people.
Yeah. Right?
That guy wasn't the witness. That guy wasn't the original witness.
Right.
So, and then they each read the card.
The famous lineup scene.
All right, you all know the drill. When your number is called, step forward and repeat the phrase you've been given. Understand? Number one, step forward.
Hand me the keys, you fucking cocksucker.
Number two, step forward.
fucking keys, you fucking cocksucker motherfucker!
Knock it off, get back. Number three, step forward.
Hand me the keys, you cocksucker.
In English, please.
Excuse me.
In English.
How many fucking keys? You cocksucker, what the fuck?
Number four, step forward.
It was bullshit. The whole rap was a setup.
Hand me the keys, you fucking cocksucker.
It was all the cops' fault. You don't put guys like that into a room together.
Five, step yep. Who knows what? Hand me the keys, you cocksucker. It's great. McManus goes crazy. Fenced is the best.
In English, please.
Yeah, in English, yep. In English, please. They're all laughing. I guess they were joking on the set because
you're gonna say it, yeah.
He was farting a bunch of times.
I guess Bryan Singer was getting
angry at him
because they were kept doing it silly and like joking. And like even when they hit each other, it almost felt like that was just kind of ad libbed.
It was funny to see them joking around because it's like Keaton seemed to always be mad at them. You know what I mean?
He was like the dad almost.
Yeah, but it made him seem a little camaraderie.
I guess after the fact, Bryan Singer looked at everything and realized those were the best takes. So he took the ones that were the funniest.
Nice. Yeah, it's good stuff. And then shows each of them getting interviewed, right? McManus is talking smack. Trek with the guns, fuck out. Ooh, you know, then the cop trying to trick Fenster. McManus already told us the story. Yeah. He's like, the dysentery? I think I can do some Fenster imitations. They always work as partners, obviously. And the guy's like, what are you saying? The guy doesn't know what he's saying. And then that's when he's like, he'll flip you. What are you saying? He'll flip you for real. And then Hockney's talking smack.
That was, right? Didn't that, they said we could.
Hockney's my favorite on the stand, like when he was getting interviewed. Yeah. He was
we can put you in Queens that night. Yeah. He's like,
I Queens that night. Yeah. Really? I live in Queens. You put that together yourself, Einstein. You have a team of monkeys working on it. It's great. So, what happens if you.
What happens if you go to prison?
Your father in the shower and then have a snack? Don't clip that, Mike. You get to charge me, dickhead, and then it cuts to Keaton. Cops call him a dead man. That's right. Oh, he says he was the real prize for them. Keaton doesn't say much. The other guys are talking back and shit like that. But you obviously Keaton not a favorite because Keaton says, you get to charge me with this shit. I'll be, you know, he says something and they punch him. You know.
Well, you don't know as Keaton's an ex-cop, obviously, and yes, already exactly. There's already a lot of bullshit between them. But
that's what I'm saying. That's what
he's not want to be there either, and he knows that like he's fucked. Everything he's trying to do to be clean is being fucked, and he tried to cooperate, but then at that point he was like, "All right, fuck this." And you can see that he's just the disdain for the cops.
Like he's trying to go legit, but he's like, even that, just getting picked up ruined it.
Yep. Well, he basically says, your fault, it's not mine. So you're just now trying to tag someone on this. Sorry,
guys. Yes, exactly. It's your fault, exactly. And then so they're all together in the cell. Keaton's like, feels like he's kind of above them, right? He doesn't want anything to do with them. And then they're all talking to him because Keaton's kind of a legend. They heard he was dead. Hockney said, I heard you went straight. He's tapping Eve Finneran. McManus is kind of ragging on him. Keaton, I just like the interplay between him. Keaton tells Fenster to tell his friend to keep quiet. They're always butting heads, those two. And Keaton says the whole thing's a shakedown. There's no way we had five felons in a lineup.
This whole thing was a shakedown.
What makes you say that?
How many times you been in a lineup? It's always you and four dummies. PD are paying homeless guys $10 a head half the time. And there's no way they'd line five felons in the same role. No way. And what's a vice lineup? Public defender could get you out of that one.
So why the hell was I a strip search?
It was the feds. A truckload of guns get snagged. Customs comes down on top of NYPD looking for answers.
Hockney asks, who was the gimp?
My asshole tonight.
Did I mention, they mentioned later, you could always tell three men in a... when Agent Kujan says, you know, you get three guys, you arrest three guys for murder, three guys in a cell. There's always one guy who's, you know, sleeping. You know, right, that's the guy.
The guilty guy is the guy who's sleeping because he's.
So yeah. It's kind of like, right, it's kind of a foreshadowing that Hockney's laying down on the bed, relaxing. He's the one who stole the truck. So, yeah. So Keaton, they ask who the gimp is. Keaton tells him it's Rebel Ken. He's okay. It's Roger, really. People say I talk too much. Hockney's like, yeah, I was going to tell you to shut up.
That was funny because he wasn't saying anything.
Exactly. McManus says he has a job. Keaton doesn't want to hear it. And so McManus is like, I'm going to talk to everybody else, you know, exercising my right to free assembly. His voice even sounds like Alec.
Oh, yeah. Sometimes they all, yeah.
Right. So the other Baldwins didn't pan out quite the same.
No, they had their moments.
I guess Alec has to really.
Yeah.
What's that? Alec didn't.
Hasn't as of late either.
As of late, yeah.
Geez. Yeah, right. Yeah, Steven never killed anyone on set.
God.
I was going to make a Pauly Shore joke, but.
No. So Keaton tells him to shut up, wants nothing to do with any of them, wants to go straight, tells them they can all go to hell. So McManus is like, fuck him. You know, I'm talking to these guys. Verbal says, what I know now that these men would never break. Like I said, you're kind of rooting. You're rooting for this. Right.
They're like the gang, like the, you know what I mean?
Right. So San Pedro, present day, burned bodies on the dock, FBI agent, the great Giancarlo Esposito. Oh,
he's so freaking young in this.
On Breaking Bad yet? Have you seen?
Dave's having conversations.
I know. At least he's mute. Yeah, muted.
My son's asking me all sorts of dumb questions. I'm sorry.
Well, your son, Andrew, should shut the fuck up.
Dumb questions.
Andrew, what's go away.
You want to know?
Or join the show.
You want to know how old he was?
It's saying fucking how old you are and what's your mom.
What is this? Are we back to Almost Famous? He doesn't know how old he is.
Did you hold him back? He wanted to know how old he was. That's good. So again, Giancarlo Esposito, Dave, I don't know if you heard that. The great Gus Frey.
He has no idea what we're talking about still.
He's asking if any survived. He's one of them's at the hospital. DA is the cripple from New York. It pans in, it shows
that's a little dated that they called the guy a cripple. Yeah,
they said a few times, it's a cripple.
Yeah. Why, that's not acceptable now? It pans up, but you see the carnage. It was great. The plane that you show, the plane landing, Agent Kujan's. It's Agent, is it Jeff's message? Dan Hedaya. He's Hedaya, awesome.
Yeah.
Right. He's a riot.
Oh, yeah. He's always great.
Great 80s. Great 80s actor.
So he was, commentary was in New York. That's where he picked up.
He flies there
because they, yeah.
And he obviously knows Jeff, which I have pretty soon when I get to it. So Jeff Rabin, which they use his office. And he's a slob, which is
good thing they did.
Exactly. So they're talking about Verbal holding on a misdemeanor. Agent Kujan wants to talk to him, friendly chat. Wants to have an interview right in Sergeant Raven's office.
What I didn't get, though, is that they didn't want to have that chat because he was so well-connected that everyone was a part of this, getting him the immunity. Why was that?
Yeah, I think because his lawyer, right?
So, like, this lowly guy gets a lawyer that is so high up in the food chain that the governor's calling, the mayor's calling, everyone else is calling for this guy to get him.
Yeah. That's a good question.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. How they would be pulling strings, but.
I think that was the first tip when I watched it. The second guy, like, why is he so important? You know, this little, as they call him.
Right. Agent Kujan wants to just, thinks there's more to this story. I want to know why 27 men died on the boat. We're a $91 million drug deal that wasn't there. I also he basically really wants to know that Dean Keaton is dead, right?
That's yeah. all he cares about, yeah.
Dean Keaton's his white whale, right? Cut to the hospital. The FBI agent, Bear is his name, wants to talk to the survivor. It's funny. He's like, oh, yeah, he's all fucked up when he's on the phone talking about the witness. Well, he's not the guy that's alive. He's ranting in Hungarian.
Yes. Holger Schramm.
Well, no, not
my
put him in there. Send me someone who can speak Hungarian.
Yeah, he's awake. He's talking
like a Thai hooker.
Lata ma Kaiser Schüsse. Nemetes.
What?
Kaiser Schüsse.
And then he gets his attention when he says Kaiser Schüsse.
Yeah. Even everybody seems to know. It's like a legend.
Yep. FBI guy says, call Dan.
That's a smart take, Mikey.
Don't you have a son to go talk to? I mean, you've been
the whole thing's about a legend. The legend of, yeah, good point. Thanks for bringing that. I'm sorry, Chris. I'm sorry.
It's okay. I like this. Is what I love. The heat between you guys is what this, you know.
Oh, he wishes there was heat.
It's what gets the ratings. Different kind of heat.
Yeah.
Friction. The friction between us is palpable.
All right. Bad time to bring that up with Spacey on the butt. Okay. Verbal's in the office alone. He's looking at everything, right? On the bulletin board.
See, that's what I was like.
Oh, great.
When you go back the second time, you think, oh, he's just
you kind don't of. Notice it anyway. Good yeah. foreshadowing, as Dave likes to say. So Kujan introduces himself. He wants to talk about Keaton. Asks for coffee. Says he gets dehydrated as a kid. This is when he says his piss comes out like snot. Pretty irritating. You could tell Jeff, I'll call him Jeff, Sergeant Ravine. He's like irritated by him right away. I'll go get it.
Yeah.
That guy is tense. Tension is a killer. I used to be in a barbershop quartet in Skokie, Illinois. The baritone was this guy named Kip Diskin. Big fat guy. I mean, like orca fat. He was so stressed in the morning, you know.
Verbal, you know we're trying to help.
So, Kujan, they're recording it and they're listening in the other room. So, he asks for a cigarette. You see he has trouble lighting it. Talks about Verbal's deal, sealed testimony. And Kujan tells him the story about the murderer sleeps well. Like I said, call back. So, it says, what happens after the lineup? And then back to Keaton leaving the station. Edie bailed him out, saying he's finished. You know, it's never going to happen because they'll always be all over me. You see the other guys
looking at every other guy like, yeah, this is
you
my
see Verbal's out there doing his cripple thing. I'm saying that only because these guys called him.
Sure, yeah.
The other guys are all out there. Yeah. Verbal tells him about the score. You know, need to convince Keaton. In New York's finest taxi service. He needs to sell Keaton on it. Keaton doesn't think they operate anymore. Yeah, McManus knows a guy in the force. They want to take him without Keaton.
And like, what the hell's New York's finest?
They won't take Verbal without Keaton on the job, right? So this is when Keaton smacks him and he feels bad, right?
Right. He's like, I think.
You have a relationship that we don't know of. Like, it's obviously alluded to that they were somewhat friends.
Right, but which is funny because it's like, when did Verbal, you know,
start? I just assume Verbal's been a thing that he's done for years.
Mm-hmm.
Whenever he's like, you know, hiding or, you know, wanting to be out amongst, I don't know, the public. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, it seems risky for Kaiser, if, you know.
Well, he's so, taking a risk or two.
Yes. So he feels bad.
I wish he had that long hair, but we'll get there.
You wish what?
I wish he had really had that long, silky hair.
Oh, yeah.
That's an
awesome game of Kaiser. So, and he mentioned a fence in California where they could sell diamonds. He's telling Keaton the deal called Redfoot. Right, which we know is not the real name or not a real guy. Keaton feels bad about hitting him, sits down, he'll probably shit blood tonight. A lot of disgusting bodily fluids and functions by Verbal. Keaton asks about the plan. this part is a great, how you hear the, just has a great score. You know what I mean? You yep. see the, you see the plane landing and you hear the, you know, the score, the cops pick up the smuggler, verbal explains the illegal service, corrupt cops. They had been shut down. And the guy gives the cops money to escort them safely. And verbal had a plan so nobody would get killed. But Keaton put on the finishing touch, right? A little fuck you to the NYPD. So they do the heist. Well, the vans block them in. Right? They all have pantyhoses on their face. It's pretty funny. And McManus smashes the windshield with the sledgehammer. It's the diamonds and the money. And the guy, he's been in a few. You know who I am?
I'm the money! Hurry up! You know the fucking who? You know the fuck I am! You people know the fuck I am! Fuck!
What are you doing now, jerko?
Yeah, that was great. They took the badge. Yeah.
Pulled back with the machine gun, right? And they dump gas on him, McManus, and he throws a lighter. It's great. Keaton made the anonymous phone call. They all got indicted. 15 other cops. Just an enjoyable quick scene, right? Yep. That scene is probably so fast. You don't, you know, when I rewatched, I didn't think it was like a 5-minute scene, right? So fast. So later they're in the garage counting diamonds. McManus says he and Fenson will go to California. They'll meet Redfoot. Hockney's like, fuck that, right?
Well, yep, that's what they say. They all
we're all going to get a little heated. Keaton tells him to cool it. I like he's like in charge of the gang now, of the crew. He says they're all go. We could all use a vacation. McManus toasts verbal, the man with the plan. Keaton wants to say goodbye to Edie. You see that? You see her look up, and then they cut back to the interview after verbal's talking about Keaton and Edie. And this was cracking me up about Jeff. He's like, "Oh, it's hot warming. I'm weepy."
Is this when he actually gets the cup of coffee? Or did that already happen? I know they talked about getting him one.
Right. I think he actually went and got him the cup of coffee when he was getting irritated.
Okay. I noticed like Palminteri standing above him and he pulls back and drinks the cup.
Yeah, right.
So Verbal can look up right under the cup. Notice,
right, that he sees the brand of porcelain of coffee cup.
How he inserted his will in that conversation, basically saying, "I'm smarter than you.
Yeah.
I'm gonna control this conversation. You're dumb.
I'm just
gonna
make it up." Purple. Yeah.
And the entire time he was playing, and I fucking loved it.
Great, but when you think about to go on and to talk about that, the reason Verbal even has this conversation and gives all this information is he needs them to think that Keaton was Kai's associate.
Yep.
That's what he needs to pretend to not think he's Kai's associate, you know? Yep. He does a great, so not only does Spacey do a great job, it's like layered where Verbal does a great job acting like yep. Keaton. He looks up to Keaton and he's kind of like his hero. And then as he gets interviewed, he almost becomes aware of the things that he didn't believe about Keaton. It's great. So Keaton was retiring, says the heist was all fenced to McManus. But you see, he's a good liar, you know, already.
Yep.
Wasn't all them. Says Kujan says he knows Keaton is bad, indicted for how many times? 7 times while on the force, died a reverse testimony, killed 3 prisoners, can't prove it. Here's the best part, can't prove. Dean Keaton was dead. Went into a building that exploded, 2 witnesses within 2 months, they were both dead. And so they cut to the hospital, the FBI is in with the witnesses, they have an interpreter.
He says they were buying dope. We know. He doesn't know what they were buying, but not dope. People.
What?
Nemirtet in Lattamus Erdogat. Lattam. Semdil Semmelattam.
He needs guarantees.
What is he talking about, guarantees? He says his life's in danger.
Semdil Semmelattam Erdogat.
He saw the devil, looked him in the eye.
I'm on my way.
No, 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 wait a minute, wait a minute. Ask him to tell him what he told me about the devil. Who's the devil?
Kaiser Söze.
He was in the harbor, killing many men.
He saw Kaiser Söze.
He saw his face.
Tell him to tell her what he looks like. Describe him.
I love that little part where the other guy, he's like, he saw Kaiser Söze. He's like, holy shit.
Like, yeah, even like all, everything else he said, then you heard Kaiser Söze and the guy was like,
yeah, because he was leaving. He's like, what is this for? Oh, he saw the devil. Great. And he starts firing. And then they start on the police sketch. So Kujan tells Verbal he heard Keaton was eating out with his lawyer. They couldn't prosecute him.
I thought that was a dirty, double entendre, but maybe not.
But everything is, Mike. You know.
To me, yeah.
So,
you're on mute, idiot. We can't hear you.
You're on mute.
Okay, now you're not on mute. You were on mute before.
I'm mute the entire time. You just shook my head because you're disgusting.
You said something.
You're a filthy animal. So should I?
So. This is where Kujan gets aggravated with Verbal. He thinks he's stupid, gets pissed. He says, you know, he gave me immunity, not from me. You better talk to me, you know. He's like, there was a lawyer, Kobayashi. Did he kill Keaton? No, but I'm sure he's dead. Convince me. And then you go back. Meeting with Redfoot. You know, the great Peter Green. I shouldn't call him the great Peter Green, but you know that actor. Hey,
is he Pulp Fiction? Why do I know him?
Yes. Yes, okay. He was in Pulp Fiction. Yeah. He was Jed.
Okay. Zed baby. Zed baby, yeah.
He taps the gimp on the head, right?
I mean, I was like, I know this guy, I've seen him in things, but what the hell?
He was also in The Mask. I think he was really good. He would have been hit
the mask.
He's in The Mask. Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah, so he had some drug issues. And he's very friendly to McManus. This is funny. He's like, hey, how you doing? You know, he gives the money, introduces the other guys. McManus, he mentions the other job. McManus says he'll check it out. Keaton tells him about the guy he knew, I guess he was a cop, and Booby or something. Keaton tells him he shivved him, but he heard it from me, you know.
Oh, right, yeah.
Yeah, dude.
I did it.
So Keaton gets convinced. They laugh at him like, oh, yeah, you're really out here, just one job, okay. So next job. You get that great score again. The jeweler with the bodyguards want to rob him. Keaton pulls the gun on him to get the case. He smashes the window. Guy looks away and he pulls a gun. You know, the gun goes off and the bodyguards turn the tables on Fenster and Hockney. McManus has the two guns thinking about what to do. Shoots them both at the same time. For some reason, I just had a random thought that I was like, around it, you know, I think if Stephen Baldwin kept doing what he, you know, that, if he got more roles, and I could almost see him in Saving Private Ryan as Rayburn.
Which actor is Rayburn?
Come on, it's Burns, Ed Burns.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Random thought. Sorry.
Is Dave like cutting food? Is he cutting his toenails? Oh no. Jesus Christ.
No, I'm not. I'm listening.
Well, move down. What are you showing? I want move the camera down now. I'm not going to continue this podcast. It's a toenail clipper, you fucking psychopath. Thank God you muted it. I'm surprised you didn't hear one bounce off your phone.
That is disgusting.
Just like we asked for an hour and a half of your time all day.
This is what he time. The listeners.
This is what yeah.
Mikey, you're gonna need a good drop for that. I don't know what the
Oh my god. David dickhead alert, I'll put this time.
Hey, you know what I'll tell you this though? In this movie, there was not one hot girl. Really? There's not one.
There's not one what?
You don't, there's not like one the lawyer? With a
hot girl in it.
Edie Finneran?
Yeah, she's okay.
Right? The interpreter. Yeah.
David Dick alert. Repeat. This is a David Dick alert.
All right. So
hold on. Hold on. When Verbal kills that guy, right?
Yes.
At that point, I figured he is not who he's really saying he is, right?
Right.
That was my first kind of glimpse into this guy is not genuine.
By the way, if that was accurate, that guy's an idiot. I mean, they just shot his two bodyguards. Hand over the fucking face. Keaton told them like 6 times.
Yeah.
Didn't want to kill him for some reason.
Because I think Keaton was past that. I don't think Keaton really wanted to go back.
I agree. He almost didn't want that lifestyle anymore. So, and then McManus gives a bad day. So they open the case. No, it's not Jules. It's drugs. So McManus is pissed at Redfoot. He wants to kill him. What am I supposed to do with that? I don't know. Feed it to the gimp. Keaton asks him how he set this job up. He says he's the middleman. The guy wants to meet. You know, he says, we want to meet him. But, oh, that's funny. He wants to meet you too. McManus says, happens again, I'll kill you. Such a tough guy. I love this line and the delivery. When he's like, one more thing, Keaton, the fuck off my dick. And he flicks the butt. It was supposed to hit him in the chest. It actually hit him in the eye.
Oh, dude, really?
Yeah, it wasn't supposed to. I don't know if you noticed that. That's what caused his reaction, where he was like, kind of like jumped and he flipped out, and then he goes to grab his gun. It's pretty good.
Hey, that kudos to him to not like, you know, to keep going.
Yeah, exactly. So Redfoot
guys had a bunch of machine guns. It was a real fair fight.
I know. So Redfoot hints he will he'll rat him out. He's like, oh, real shame about Saul. So back to Kujan. Kujan asks why he let this pot out when he talked to the DA. So Bear shows up, tells him about the deal on the dock.
Whatever it was, it's very sensitive.
I don't get it.
Tell me, you got the cripple in there from New York.
Yeah.
Did he mention Kaiser Soze?
Who?
Just bear with me here.
Who's Kaiser Soze?
Oh, fuck.
Kujan didn't know. I mean, he's worked for customs. So that's when he goes in and he says, who is Kaiser Soze? He's like, oh, fuck.
That was great when he was like,
it was awesome how they did that. And then they cut to the crew figuring things out. Keaton trying to figure out the setup. Pretty cool wipe shots, as Mikey says, as someone in the movie biz of Kobayashi standing there, right? You see Kobayashi standing there. You see the shots of him. They don't notice him.
Yes.
So,
yes.
Then, can I go back a second, though, real quick?
Yep.
That was a whole setup, really, for, because when they went to that, you know, they weren't intentionally trying to kill those guys. They end up killing him. I think that was kind of intentional, that they knew that was going to happen so that they'd have that on them. You know what I'm saying? Am I saying that correctly?
I know what you're saying. Like, now they've killed together and they're kind of like in it deep.
Yeah. Yes. Well, and then you have Verbal, who is trying to set them up too.
Yeah.
Wants to do this, right? He's the one who killed Saul. So that's how they get him on the hook. So
I hear a beagle.
That's my beagle. I mean, the doors are closed too. So they're trying to figure stuff out. You see Kobayashi. He mentions them all. I assume you, Mr. Verbal Candy, after he mentions them all. So he mentions his employer.
Mr. Hockney, Tuesday. Mr. Keaton. Mr. Fenster, I recognize from his mug shots, as well as Mr. McManus. I can only assume that you are Mr. Kint, the gentleman who disposed of Saul Berg. My employer sends his gratitude, a most unexpected benefit. I am Mr. Kobayashi. I have been asked by my employer to bring a proposal to you, gentlemen.
What do you want?
My employer requires your services, gentlemen. One job, one day's work. Very dangerous. He does not expect all of you to live, but those of you who do will have $91 million to divide between you in any way you see fit.
Who's your boss?
I work for Kaiser Soze.
Who's Kaiser Soze?
Judging by the sudden change in mood, Mr. Kint, I feel sure the rest of your associates can tell you.
He says, I need you for a job, a very dangerous. All of you won't survive. Who's your boss? I work for Kaiser Soze. They're all like, holy shit. And then, right, and they show verbal saying, who's Kaiser Soze? They all know. They're like, oh, fuck. So he's issuing an order, mentions all their robberies of Soze. It's pretty great. And then including Mr. Hockney, who 6 nights ago, or was it 2 weeks ago, whenever it was, robbed a truck. And he's still looking.
That's where, okay, I was like, when do we know that he did that? It's
yeah.
It's that's him. Well, who this guy is.
He shrugs. So, and then he admits he set up the lineup, but Edie got them out too fast. You're only alive because you didn't know who you stole from. So Hockney pulls the gun. He's like, why shouldn't we kill you right now? And then he's like, well, we can, you know, pin you for Saul's murder, which we will surely do if you don't comply. And then he tells them about the deal, $91 million worth of cocaine deal on the boats. But wants them to stop the deal. Get on the boat, kill everyone, destroy the coke, and they'll be free of obligation.
Keep and he
gives
the
them the briefcase. Yep, gives them the briefcase, all their files, the map of the boat, but the file for each one.
And he's basically blackmailing them into it.
Yep. Very good.
They show all the information about their lives, pictures of...
I could cancel you off the show. Like I could just erase, you know, delete you off the show.
Edit.
No one would know.
You can edit that out.
We'll edit everything out. I'm going to add a filter to your
voice. Just said they basically blackmail them. Wow. Yes. All their files are in the briefcase for everything they've done, including juvenile delinquency.
Down to five. So Keaton's like, this guy's a pipe dream. Fence is talking about Kaiser. Some kind of butcher. Back to verbal telling Kujan who Kaiser Soze was. This is great. The greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist.
That line is legendary.
One story the guys told me, the story I believe, was from his days in Turkey. There was a gang of Hungarians that wanted their own mob. They realized that to be in power, you didn't need guns or money or even numbers. You just needed the will to do what the other guy wouldn't. After a while, they come into power, and then they come after Soze. He was small time then, just running dope, they say. They come to his home in the afternoon, looking for his business. They find his wife and kids in the house and decide to wait for Soze. His wife raped and children screaming. The Hungarians knew Soze was tough, not to be trifled with, so they let him know they meant business. They tell him they want his territory, all his business. Soze looks over the faces of his family. Then he showed these men of will what will really was. Rather see his family dead than live another day after this. He lets the last Hungarian go. He waits until his wife and kids are in the ground, and then he goes after the rest of the mob. He kills their kids, he kills their wives, he kills their parents and their parents' friends. He burns down the houses they live in and the stores they work in. He kills people that owe them money. And like that, he's gone. Underground. Nobody's ever seen him since. He becomes a myth, a spook story that criminals tell their kids at night. Rat on your pop, and Kaiser Soze will get you. And no one ever really believes.
Do you believe in him, Verbal?
Keaton always said, I don't believe in God, but I'm afraid of him. Well, I believe in God, and the only thing that scares me is Kaiser Soze.
Now, this whole story, I know the visualization is obviously bullshit. It's like fantasizing of it, but the whole, do you think the whole thing is bullshit?
I think it's believable. That's what he legit does in his life.
I don't think you know because you. I don't think you're supposed to even know whether the legend, because it's kind, it's a legend. It's a fairy tale, right, like he says, but obviously, it's him.
Yeah, and I did read that the screenwriter, based that on a real guy who, like, I don't know, to get out of something, killed his whole family, and then went into hiding.
That was wild. It was awesome how they showed the clip too. So the Hungarians take his family, comes home.
He's got this long hair, this big guy.
No, business. Yeah, and then I love the way Verbal says it. You know, Sose looks over the faces of his family. Then he shows these men of Will what Will really was. Shoots everyone. He kills his wife, kids. Then he shoots all but one guy. And then when his wife and kids are in the ground, he kills the kids. Kills the bad guys' kids, their parents, friends, burns everything down. It's awesome, just like that.
But I think perfect. Yes, but I think it's not perfect that he kill all those people. But
no, that's what he does. Poof. Yes, we get a chef's kiss.
I genuinely think that there's a lot of truth in that story because he is. There's a legend behind him, yes, but he's created that legend. Fucking insane. I think he's maniacal. His background, this whole thing was set up.
Yeah, no, there's an argument to be made, right? But that's how he is who he is.
I think that this movie, because it actually makes people speculate and debate what the reality actually is. Like, I think
even the movie is. He says he knows all this stuff about Kaiser Soze here, but in the flashback, he goes, "Who's Kaiser Soze?" So,
right.
Was that a clue? I don't know. Was that like, I don't know. You know what I'm talking about?
Well, he says, or did he just didn't know who he was that? when yeah. Well, right. He says he didn't know who he was with Paul Sawyer.
Okay.
And then he's saying now about, he heard about, supposedly he learned about it, but again, he's so right. Not a lot of what he says did not happen. We know certain things happened.
Yep.
Right. But we know there was a lineup. We know that all that's that.
Yeah, we can assume Benicio del Toro is buried at the beach. And...
Yep. So, so then he's talking about Kaiser Soze, and then he's like, just like that, he's gone, and then nobody's ever seen him since. He's become a myth, And then Agent Kuyanda asks him if he believes in him. And he's like, Teton's always said, I don't believe in God, but I'm afraid of him. Well, I believe in God, and the only thing that scares me is Kaiser Soze. So Kujan's trying to get Verbal into attorney state's evidence. He hadn't mentioned Kaiser Soze before. He says it will protect you from him. He's laughing. He's like, he has a burner under your ass to let me go so he can scoop me up. He's like, this was great. Honestly, Spacey was awesome acting in scenes, mostly in the interview, like laughing at him. And he's like, the cops fucked it all up. They'll never get Soze. Might only show his face to get rid of me. So cut to the hospital. The guy's given the description. Verbal goes back to the next story. Fenster took off. He was freaked out. That night we got the call. Kobayashi told us where we can find Fenster. McManus, they show Fenster. McManus wants to bury him with their hands, and they're all arguing. Hockney and McManus butting heads again. Hockney's like, fuck you. Keaton says he's finishing this thing. Kobayashi's not going to stand by. He's kind of pissed off at Kobayashi, right? He's like, is he guys associate? He's, yep. He had a murder. He wants revenge. He starts digging the hole with McManus. I'm sure McManus respects him a little now. So back to the interview. Verbal's talking about Keaton. This is funny. He says he's talking about criminals, and it's like, things are always simple on the street. They're always, there's no arch criminal. How it really is, and it's like literally he's an arch criminal.
Yeah, they're saying like it's the simplest explanation. If you think if someone dies, you think the brother killed them, it's probably the brother.
Exactly, which is not simple in this case. Nothing simple about this. So let's see, they want to hit Kobayashi. And so I guess McManus with the glasses, it was like a paid homage to Bruce Lee. I think it was a movie. So they kill the bodyguards in the elevator. McManus tells them to go to floor 20. And like I said, you're like rooting for them. You're like hoping they kill Kobayashi. He's like, listen, you cocksucker, there is no Kaiser Soze. He's like, we changed our minds. And then he says, whatever you threaten me with is ludicrous compared to what would happen if I didn't follow through.
His delivery just is like creepy. It's just so directive.
Perfect. Yeah. He doesn't lose control, doesn't get excited.
Yeah. Awesome. Like he's about to get shot and he's like, McManus is like, I'm going to be the one to kill you. I just wanted you to know that. He's about to shoot me. He's like, can I do one thing? I just want to finish my business with Miss Finner. And they're like, oh, shit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You say? She's upstairs. I requested her for an extradition deposition. Tells him to kill away after that. And he's like, and they're like, oh, you're lying. And he's like, and they show him that Edie's there. And then the tide's obviously turns. He's like, you go get some rest. Anything happens again, Miss Finneran will find herself the victim of a gruesome violation. And Hockney, as will Hockney's dad and verbal Uncle Randall in Arizona. I might only castrate your nephew, Mr. McManus. Good sinister.
He's not just some toady.
Yeah. All right. So they're casing the boat. Keaton's planning it out.
I assume Dave turned his camera off because he's shaving his chest right now or something.
Yeah, either that or
taking a shit.
Tweezing something.
Tweezing gray hairs or putting new ones in.
Yes, or, plugs. Oh,
he's gone completely. It's going to completely fuck up the recording, I think.
As long as he's here for the end. Yeah. So
we're not stopping. Screw him.
Can't be done, Keaton says. Anyone goes in, they're not coming out alive. He says, we can't wait for the money. There'll be 10 more men. Of course, McManus and Hockney want to wait for the money, So outside on the docks, this is great,
Great. Hey, Dave, are you connected to the audio?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm doing that so I can sync it later.
Because
you might end up with two audio tracks and they need to put it in, make sure everything syncs because you fucking.
Oh, I see. Because he left. Yeah. That's in the biz name, Dave.
Yeah, man.
Sorry, guys.
Dave, do you have an old filter on?
No, why?
You look great.
Good. That one on?
Or yes, I do.
You do?
No, I'm. That's me.
Okay, just pure fat in you. Cool.
That's what I am. Thank you.
Silence. Awkward silence. Filter. So back to the docks. Dave, they're about to make the hit, whatever they do. So
they still think they're there for the drug deal.
Yes.
Yeah. So they hear the guy speaking, they're not sure what language. Verbal points out that's Hungarian. So Verbal knows Hungarian. McManus is on the
right.
Roof.
That's right. Yeah.
Hockney says packages has arrived, the money. McManus sets up a sniper tripod, he's talking on the radio. This is when Keaton wants Verbal to stay out, keep the money, go to Edie if I don't make it. And Keaton walks down the dock towards the boat. Guys come out to stop him, and they're like, what the hell? McManus
what the hell is he just kind of just walking right in there?
I know. Yeah. So, right. But they're not going to just shoot somebody that, Like he's.
Yeah.
And then McManus counts out the seven guys, the Oswald line. Which, what was funny? That aggravated me at the time because I'm like, I think it was soon after JFK. And I'm like, it wasn't Oswald. It was,
damn it.
Oswald was a patsy. So.
You still feel that way?
Do I?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't want to get in. I don't want to go off on a tangent here.
A 4-hour JFK tangent.
So Keaton asked the guy if there's a problem. And they're obviously suspicious. Hockney sets up the explosives, walks out. You see the walks out with a machine gun, like he's part of the crew, right? Even riskier. And then McManus does the old McDonald's, shot some guys. And then you see the buildup, the explosion. McManus taking out a bunch of guys. Hockney starts taking out guys.
They're just taking out people left and right. Any open door, boom.
They kick some ass. McManus says Ellis has left the building, slides down the rope. It's kind of a badass in this movie. Keaton saves Hockney right before he's about to get shot. They show the guy in the, they show somebody shuffling some guy to safety on the boat. They are laying waste, and Hockney is outside, runs towards the guy. He does the vamanos, shoots the guy. So, because he comes back out, right? Gets to the back of the van. This is great. Opens the box. Boom.
Dead.
You know, blood sprays on the money. He turns around slowly. Face is lit up. Awesome. And then you see Verbal somewhere else, right? Mr. Reliable narrator. Keaton and McManus are searching the boat. They go back to the interview. Why didn't you run? You know, Bear comes in. They found a body in the harbor. He was the one who was being extradited, was a big rat named Kaiser Sose.
Right. So this whole thing was getting these guys that he knew would never get out to go in and kill this guy who ratted on
him. Witness.
Just take everybody out.
Exactly. So, so this is when Kujan comes back in. I'll tell you what I know. Stop me if this sounds familiar. There was no dope on that boat. It's great, great how that shot too. And then it goes, cuts back, and then back on the boat. Arturo, the witness, in his room, looking scared. The door opens, and you see the other guy. I'm telling you know. And he's like, I'm telling you, it's Kaiser Sose.
Kaiser Sose.
So he. Guy shuts the door. Keaton and McManus are searching everywhere. Pretty cool job with the camera. They show you the whole boat. You know, they like see the pans around. They're like, where's Hockney? I don't know. There's no coke. What? You heard me, you dumb fuck. This and this. So there goes their camaraderie. You know, he's like, there's no fucking coke.
Yeah.
Back to Arturo. The door opens and the guy slumps dead and you see a shadow. And he's like, I told him nothing. Yeah. So you see the gunshots from outside the window. So,
yep.
And then you Verbal looking nervous again. So, and then, you know, like I said, you see Verbal, and then, you know, it can't be accurate because you see McManus walking out. Strangest thing, falls forward. You see the knife in the back, you know, the base. And then you see Verbal limping around. He sees Hockney checking his body, shows, you know, and then it shows the point of view of whoever's going to shoot Keaton, and you hear the gunshots. And then, like I said, I felt cheated the first time because I was like, but it's really the brilliance of the storytelling. Mm-hmm. So Keaton goes down, you see Kaiser standing up there, Verbal's looking scared. Back to the interview, Kujan's, you know, doesn't think Keaton's dead. He bullies him. He's like, you know, did you see Keaton get shot? He's like, why didn't you help him? You know, he does the old, I knew it was the devil itself. How do you shoot the devil in the back? What if you miss? And he shows him his hand. Let's get back to the dock. Shows Verbal behind the ropes. Shows Kaiser shoot Keaton, like you see like a point of view, which never happened. It drops the lighter and leaves. You can see a close-up of the ropes, which is nobody's there right there.
Yep.
That's what you use. It's just something's wrong with this story. So Kujan tells Verbal about Arturo. And like I said, it's just so great to get him to think that Keaton was Kaiser Sose, but he was pretending to not think he was him. You know, it's almost like Kujan's breaking down his beliefs in Keaton.
Yeah.
So he lays out the thing, and this is pretty awesome. He's like, Edie was the tie to Arturo. You know, that's how Keaton knew. He knew he could get all those guys to do the job. And this is pretty awesome how the montage of, you know, him hitting Verbal. He was my friend. And he's like, no, he wasn't. Keaton had no friends. Keaton was Kaiser Sose, the man who could orchestrate a police lineup. You know, a man who could kill Edie Finner. And he's like, what? She was found shot twice in the head. And then they show his face as Kaiser Sose, Keaton. And then you could see Verbal kind of like buying it, right?
Hearing up, carrying on.
Yeah. You didn't really see him die, did you? He's like, you know, why me? Why did he why not Fenster and McManus? Because he's like, I'm stupid because you're stupid, Verbal. Thanks. Yeah, you think so, buddy. It was this idea to hit the New York taxi service, wasn't it? And then he's like, yes. And that's Kujan's like, yes. You know, I knew it was him. And he wants him to turn to state's evidence. No way. I'll take my chances. He walks out. He's like, fucking cops. So Kujan talking to Jeff. This is when they're in there. He's drinking the coffee. He's kind of relieved that it's almost like I knew it was Keaton. I got him. At least figured it out. Keaton was behind all this stuff. He set it all up.
His right, relaxed kind of demeanor, just kind of nonchalantly looking at the bulletin board. And then,
yeah, well, he suddenly, you know, he's telling him what a slob he is.
Yeah.
Right. He's like, you should see my garage. And then they show Verbal claiming his property.
One watch, gold. One cigarette lighter, gold. And a pack of cigarettes, thank you.
A gold lighter. A gold watch.
Yeah. And
the other cop is faxing the picture. And Kujan calls Jeff a slob. He's drinking coffee. Like I said, he's like you said, he's relaxed. And you see the barbershop quartet. You see the quartet, right away.
It's quartet in from Skokie, Illinois. Yeah.
Yes, exactly. And you see drops of coffee right away. It shows it off. And then you see it slow motion. And then you hear the clips of Verbal's interview.
Tell me every
list. Back when I was in that barbershop quartet in Skokie, Illinois.
Where's your head, Agent Kujan?
What we need to do is think. Think back.
I'm sure you've heard many tall tales.
Bricks Marlin.
This isn't right.
I just want to hear your story.
It's all there. And I'm telling it straight, I swear.
Some guy in California, his name is Redfoot.
A gift from Mr. Sose.
Talk to me, Verbal.
What about Redfoot?
Mr. Redfoot knew nothing. Using pawns.
Big, fat guy. I mean, like, orca fat.
There was a lawyer.
Myths and legends of
Kobayashi.
I've never seen him again. Back when I was picking beans in Guatemala, we used to make fresh coffee.
I know you thought he was a good man.
I know he was good.
Tell me every last detail.
Strangest thing.
How do you shoot the devil in the back?
This orca is protected from up on high by the prince. Tell me every last detail.
What about a pretzel, man? What's your story?
There was a lawyer. What lawyer, Verbal?
I am Mr. Kobayashi.
Kobayashi. Kobayashi. Tell me every last detail.
I work for Kaiser Soze.
What lawyer, convince Verbal? Convince me.
And all the pieces, then you see it pans in on the Kobayashi on the coffee cup.
And the red foot, the big fat orca. Yeah.
That's not Mikey. Don't. What the fuck?
That's what they said. God. Dave, remember the first half of this episode when you were really bringing it? Was that during the conversation with Andrew or the nail clipping?
And throw clips in.
Yeah.
Throw your clever quips in. Disperse them throughout. Don't worry. Don't listen to him, Dave.
Just keep adding those, Mikey, throughout the entire pod.
I will. You'll be good.
So you see Kujan runs out. Which way did the cripple go?
Again, the crow, yeah.
You see the voiceover of the interview with Verbal walking down the street, and all-time great.
Great.
You know, holy shit moment when you see the limp. Like so many times, it's shot so well, right? How they do the limp, and then it's a regular walk.
I'm not gonna lie.
You confused?
I started watching the close up. The first time I started watching the close up of him walking, I knew he was gonna stop.
That was the moment.
I did.
That's awesome.
He's gonna turn that fucking cripple into a normal, easy. And it wasn't even like, I mean, hurry up and run. He was nonchalantly just walking. I loved it. It was fucking genius.
It was awesome. They did it. And then you see the police sketch of Verbal come out, right? Did I already mention Spacey was the subject of two sketch artists? I mean, how many people were the subject of sketch artists in two movies?
Was that seven?
Yeah, he was in seven also.
How was that? I would like to compare those sketches.
I know, honestly. So then you see him straighten his hand out, right? He lights the cigarette, gets in the car, and then you see Kobayashi.
The greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist. And like that, he's gone.
And just like that. So excellent movie, so entertaining.
Kevin Spacey's best movie? Would you say, I know you love to rank, Chris. So
his best performance or his best movie?
No,
I think both. I'm trying to think what else he was in that.
K-Pax? I never saw it.
American Beauty?
American Beauty.
He was unbelievable. He was unbelievable in this.
That's right.
He was better in this.
It was, yeah.
And it was his best movie. In my top 10, he's in my top Usual Suspects, in my top 10 movies of the real 10, not just the top 20, top 10.
I think the top ten fluctuates a little bit every once in a while.
Yeah, give us a quick top 20 of Kevin Spacey roles.
Top 20, okay. really? You know what was great is Glengarry Glen Ross.
I've never seen that movie.
What the fuck?
I've never seen it either.
What are you guys doing?
Wait, you know what? I feel like I might have started
it. Weren't out in bars.
Mikey was definitely beating the meat for a while there.
Yes, I was, but I mean, still treating it like
taffy. He was saltwater tapping.
Yes. Yes.
You don't need to edit this out.
Nah, I'm not going to edit this by now.
But honestly, how did you guys miss? All right, let me make one wrong.
I don't know. But anyway, you know what?
Excellent
this
movie.
This was an excellent movie, an award-winning movie, one of the most beloved movies of 1995. But you know what else is a beloved movie of 1995?
Well done, Mike.
Thank you. Our next film, the next episode of Fine Movies, Fine Spirits, we will be going back to the early days of Adam Sandler.
Back to school time.
We go back to school with Adam Sandler when we watch Billy Madison. What a turn. We go from award-winning movie, Parasite. We go to Almost Famous. We go to Casablanca, Usual Suspects. And now we're going to go see Billy Madison.
It's this,
honestly, one of the best movies of the early 90s. Actually, midnight, right?
Chef's Kiss.
95, literally mid-90, yeah.
So
it is a movie that I don't know the last time I've seen it all the way through. It's one of those things where you catch it.
Me too.
When it's on.
However, that's what you question, did it stand up or not? And you go back and watch it. It stands up. It's fucking hilarious.
Yes, it is. That's why I love Sandler.
Fantastic.
Can't wait.
Just do a little house cleaning here. You can find us on Twitter at @fine_movies, on Instagram at @fine_movies_fine_spirits, and online at fansautoexperts.com/fine_movies. Christopher, any closing thoughts?
Nope, no thoughts. Just training for a marathon.
Really? That's right. I knew that. I think. I don't know.
I have a thought.
It's a big one. It's not the real one.
Oh,
I have a thought.
Oh, that's right. I did joke about that before.
Yeah. You guys are old.
You have a thought? Dave, any thoughts?
You guys are old like me too, right? Do you ever get,
are you pulling?
Yeah, you ever get long out of nowhere, long eyebrow hairs, just out of nowhere.
Yeah.
And like, it's like they grow overnight. Where does that fucking come from?
We talk about great movies while drinking. We talk about great movies while drinking. Yeah, we talk about great movies while drinking.
Subscribe.
We feel fine.
There was it's a wild movie with wild characters that goes down smooth like honey. That's why I bought it.
David. I'm glad I hit record before that.
I know, me too. That'll be at the end.
Fans Not Experts.